Welcome back with full stomachs, I hope, or a lot of energy anyway. So before the break, we discussed HTML, and before that, we had a course introduction, and I got a question in the break, during the break, that I think it's important to address right now, and it's about the assignment or assignments in the course. You are going to work with Git, version handling using Git. In other courses, you might be familiar with Subversion or any other code versioning system, but in this course, we will use Git. And you will also hand in all assignments on GitHub. So this organization, most of the stuff, the presentations, the content, is on our GitHub organization, that is github.org/1dv525. So you can visit that organization if you like. Somewhere like in this afternoon or tomorrow, we will start generating GitHub repositories for all of you. So all of you will get repositories on GitHub that are connected to this course or on this course organization. Those will be private for your eyes only and our eyes, of course. And that's the way you hand in code to us. So every assignment have a GitHub repository connected to that assignment, and you have one to spare, which is called like exercises or something like that. You can use that exercise repo as a training center or where you stuff all other exercises, because there are exercises. We have the assignments, but there are exercises as well that we provide solutions for, so that you can have those as practice. And those exercises are mainly for part 2 and 3. But I got a question: how many commits must we do? Is it okay to commit everything in the end, or must we do a commit for more or less everything we change? I would say that the answer is somewhere in between. You should not, or it's not okay, to just do one commit in the end and send it in. We need some kind of confirmation, some kind of Git version history, so we can see that you have been working with the assignment on a okay matter. We have this plagiarism problem in computer science, and one way to stop some students from copying other students' code is to, if you are able to show a Git version history, that's okay. You are not so suspicious when it comes to plagiating or copying another student's code. So during the examination, we will actually look at your versioning, your commit history. And what is a good commit history? Well, you should have normally try to work with Git as you are supposed to work with version handling. So if you're fixing a feature, make that into one commit. So you're okay, so now my task is to link in all the CSS files. Okay, do that, and then do a commit calling it linking in all the CSS files. Okay. Go to the next part problem that you have in your list. Okay, so now what I need to do is start testing and changing the color of the background and changing the font colors and stuff. So okay, change the colors, and then make a commit, call it changing colors, whatever. So try to find a balance. I would say that for the first assignment, maybe somewhere between 15 and 30 commits, something like that. But don't take it as a rule of thumb. Just, is it one? One is too less. Two is too few as well. 200 is probably way too much. So try to find a balance. If you are unsure, please continue that conversation in Slack, and we can together find some middle ground. Will you be rejected at the examination if you only have one commit? No, but we will probably ask you a lot trickier questions to make sure that you have actually written the code. So That's how we do it. And if we are suspicious, maybe we will have to hand it in to the center for cupping. I don't know what's it called. In Swedish it's... I forgot a word. But there are people handling that kind of questions anyway. So we will have to hand it over to them. Well, any other questions during the break? Okay, so now we talked about HTML. Now we are looking at, and HTML, the most important thing was that HTML is just structure. Just try to logically structure the page so that it's, I mean, it's a good thing to, even if you're coding HTML and CSS on the same time, more or less, it's good to take a step back and switch off the CSS and just see, okay, is this looking good even without CSS? Just to get this logical and semantic HTML page. And then you can switch on CSS again. Because CSS is all about taking this, converting it to this, or something like that. So, I mean, we have, I showed you CSS in Garden, for example. We have this, we're just adding style rules, and we get something like this, or some mobile-friendly, responsive web page. So when it comes to styles, there are already styles in the browser. Even if we look at this page, this is full of styles, because the browser has default styles. And that's, I said on the last lecture that in the beginning the background was gray. And that's because back in the day, browsers said that in their internal style sheet, a background is gray, it's not transparent. So you don't see through the browser window, it's gray. Or as they have changed it to white now. Links are blue, they are purple when visited. Text is blackish, it has this Times New Roman font or whatever, but this is up to the browser manufacturer. So different browsers could have different margins and paddings of paragraphs. So you need to know that the browser has a built-in style sheet. It's quite common to use something called reset CSSs. It's not that common anymore. It was really important when the browsers differenced more. Today they are quite alike, but you can use something called a reset CSS that actually makes sure that all styles rules are exactly the same in all browsers from the start. Often we will talk about it in the end, you will probably use frameworks, and those frameworks will do that work for you, so you don't need to worry about it then. Upon the browser's built-in style sheets, the user can make changes. If you have some kind of vision problem, you can change contrast and stuff, and we can't... So we can't exactly know how our starting point is. But then we have developer style sheets upon this. That's what we can, as developers, can work with. And there are three of them, inline, embedded, and external style sheets. I would say you should focus on the last one, external style sheets. External style sheets is files. So you have a CSS file with a CSS code in it, and you link the HTML to, or you link the CSS file into the HTML document. You should not use inline styles and embedded styles to that extent. There are special cases, of course. We could have a look at those three examples. The first one, inline style sheets, you just add the style directly as an attribute on the HTML tag. So in this case, we have a P tag. We have used the attribute style, and then we add some style rules. So we say that the color should be something on this paragraph, and text align center, it should be centered text. And then we get a centered and bluish kind of text. The problem is with using this kind of inline styles, the next paragraph you need to copy. If you want more paragraphs having centered blue text, you need to copy the style rules to another p tag and another p tag and another p tag. And if you have multiple pages, you need to copy that even more. Don't repeat yourself. Dry. You know the concept, right? And in programming, you like write functions or methods when you feel like you are repeating yourself. So this is not a good way of doing it. It's quite simple to use when testing stuff. So I want to test something, okay, I just write it on the tag to see if it works. Problem with test-ish code is that it sometimes stays that way. So try to have a workflow that doesn't involve you writing a lot of code, style code directly on the p tag, because then we are nesting stuff together. Then we are actually in the HTML document telling it how to present itself. And that will be a problem. Maybe not if you have one page, but as soon as you have multiple pages, bigger sites, that will be a problem. There are exceptions to this rule when it comes to JavaScript later on. If you're going to dynamically move stuff, you might have to alter style properties of an element directly. That's okay. There are smart ways to do it good and not that smart ways to do it, but we will handle that in a couple of weeks. Embedded styles, they are embedded on the page, and that's a better way than inline styles. So instead of putting the style code on the tag itself, we use the style tags or the style element in the head portion of our page. Remember, the head portion is a lot of metadata. Metadata. What's it called? Metadata. Ah, a lot of stuff that are not visible for the user. It's the body code that is visible for the user. So we put a style tag in the head portion of the HTML page, and we tell it that we are using the type text CSS in this case. I don't think you need that one anymore, actually. I think it's okay to just write style. Once upon a time, this system was made so that you can have different type of styles in your page. Everybody was using CSS, so nowadays there are only CSS, so it's no use of writing that we are using CSS anymore. And inside this element, we write our style rules. I will come to those, but this one says, take every p tag on the page and color it red. So this is a better approach. We don't need to repeat ourselves, or do we? Yeah, we do, because if we are creating a new page, we need to copy this style information to the new page, right? And to the new page, and to the new page. Okay, say we can live with that. It's okay for us to copy. We have some built-in stuff on the server doing the magic for us. So we only need to write this on one place in our code anyways, and then it's distributed. It's not good anyway, because when a web page loads in the user's browser, stuff will be cached. So the next time the user visits this page, we don't need to load everything from the server again, so we get a faster experience. If we go to one page and go back to the next page, the first page was cached, so we don't need to fetch stuff from the server again. The problem with this approach is that we have 2 kilobytes of style information, then we're adding 2 kilobytes to every web page. So every page the user visits must load these 2 kilobytes of style sheets. If we instead, as is a better way, add it in a separate file, this file will be cached in the user's web browser. So the first page with visitors will download the CSS to the user's browser, and cache it. So the next time we go to another page that uses the same CSS, the browser don't need to fetch it. It's already there. So to help the browser cache stuff, it's better to use external CSS. And we get a separation as well. So the best way of doing this is to add a link tag. We need to have an attribute saying rel stylesheet to say that, okay, we are going to link in a stylesheet. You can link in other stuff, but in this case, it's a stylesheet. And we have the href attribute telling us, telling the browser where the stylesheet is. In this case, the stylesheet is in the same page or same folder as the HTML file. So if we have an index.html and a mystyle.css in the same folder, this will work. If they are in separate folders, we need to add the relative path. So if the style is in a style folder, we need to write style/mystyle.css. This could also be an absolute path, starting with HTTP and all the way to the address to our server and pointing to the CSS file. When using something called content delivery networks, which are quite usual when it comes to frameworks, the framework itself, the code for the framework will be at the server somewhere, Google server or whatever server, and we will actually load the framework from that server instead of loading it from our server. And that's because if it is on a content delivery network, it's a big chance that the user has already visited another site that used the same framework, and then it's cached in the browser. So the first visit to our page, the framework was already cached. So the browser don't need to load it upon visiting this page. But so then you can write absolute addresses. But for the first assignment, I would recommend using relative paths. Yep. Are these stuff that will change in HTTP2? We will have a deeper discussion about that. But one thing that will change is that loading a lot of files is heavy in HTTP. In HTTP2, not so much. So in HTTP2, there could be a great advantage of separating styles into many files, because the chance that you have cached the right file is higher. Instead of putting it all together in one file, that's the most common way in HTTP1.
Because this one, how we do this now, it's create a new request to our server, right?
Yeah, so exactly. So what will happen is we will visit the HTML page, and that will be a request to the server saying, okay, we want to load this HTML document. We will get the document back as a response. And request and response chain is quite costly. It takes time. And when the HTML page reaches our browser, the browser will start interpretate the page from the top to the bottom. And somewhere in the head, it will find this link. And it will say, oh, we have a style sheet. Okay, what to do? Oh, it's a referenced style sheet. It's on the server that I came from because it's a relative link. So I will contact the server with the same path as the HTML document, but I will add that I will instead want to read mystyle.css. So it will make a request to the server saying, okay, I want the mystyle.css, and the server will have to respond with that one. However, the next time we visits a page 2 with the same style sheet, we will have to do the request. We get the page 2 back. Will take some time. But then this one will be cached. So when the browser finds that line, it says, oh, in mystyle.css, I already have this one. So it will just load it from memory. there might be some changes in the HTTP2. I will concerning that, and I will have to get back to that. But one thing is certain in HTTP2, you are not punished as much when it's multiple requests. But for this first part, I think it's more important actually to structure in a good way than to think too much about HTTP requests. In the next parts, we will discuss that though. So try to use the lower one, more or less always. Those are good for testing and some special, in some special circumstances. You need to know them all anyway, because they are commonly used. Okay, let's have a look at the syntax for CSS rules. The thing that we write between the style start tag and end tag, or in the CSS document, are called CSS rules. In the CSS document, if you create a CSS file, you shouldn't add any HTML. You shall not add style tags. You should just write the CSS code. If we look at this as example, in the middle we have the p color red. If you instead have a mystyle.css file, in that file it should only have the p color red code, not the style start tag and end tag. So no HTML in the CSS files. So this could be a CSS file that we see here. So the rules, what are they made up out of? So first we have the selector, and that's the tricky part, more or less. That's the hard part. So the selector is what selects, that tells the browser what to change. So in the last page we have the p tag. So the selector was p. That's an easy one because it says take all p tags or p elements on the page and change them. But those selectors could be quite complicated. So we will put some effort into to look at them. After that you have the curly braces, and inside of that you have the property and value that we want to change. So for instance, color, colon, and then a color, in this case in a hexadecimal way, or you can write it in RGB, or there you can even write red. So if you write red, it will be red, really red, like 25500, if you look at it in RGB. You can have multiple properties and values to each selector. So you can say, okay, take all p tags and add a lot of stuff to the p tags on the page. You separate by semicolon, shouldn't be a problem for you. Newcomers who haven't programmed have a lot of problem with the semicolon, but you won't probably have that. You can omit the last semicolon, but don't, because then you will add a new row and you will forget to add the semicolon. Yeah. Yeah, I will answer that one. Yeah. So the question was, if we have a lot of different p tags and we want to change them differently, I will get to that. Yeah. So the example here says, take all the headers, one H1 elements, and change the color and background color on those elements. It's quite straightforward. Those are called tag selectors. The ones we looked at, P and H1, says take all of something on the page. We have other selectors. We have the class selector. It will look at the class attribute of an element. So on an element, you can say class something. You can say class big. On, for instance, say you have four, forget it. I have examples. Let's look at the examples instead. We have the ID selector. That will point out one exact element on the page. We have the attribute selectors that makes it so that you can select elements depending on their attributes. You could, for instance, select all the links that link to a certain page and do something with them. You have the pseudo-class selectors that I will touch upon soon. I would recommend, and this is more or less mandatory reading, I have linked it on the course webpage as well, but the MDN CSS guide for getting started with selectors. Those I won't go through them all, but most of them, but you have a complete list here with examples. So, tag selectors, we have seen them. They are easy. A single selector like that says take all on the page. That will query all H1 elements. We can use it as a descendant selector like this. So what that says is take all EM elements that are descendants of an H1 element. And descendants is that they are a child, so they are somewhere inside the H1. It don't need to be a direct child. There can be other levels. It could be a long way down the chain, but they need to be somewhere enclosed by an H1 tag. Then this one will select them. We have an example down below. So we have a PEM strong. This says take all strong elements that are inside of an EM element that in itself is inside a P element. So if you look at the example below, okay, so we have the P element that surrounds everything. Inside, we have an EM element containing a strong element. So that one, this example text will be selected. So we can change the color to blue. But the ones outside, the strong text, that will not be selected because it's not inside an EM. So you can group and chain this however you like. Okay, that's the easiest one. They're quite easy, all of them actually, but can be hard to the hard part is to know when to use what, actually. So we have the class selectors. Those are very commonly used, and I urge you to use them a lot. This is probably one of those that you will use the most. And it's quite important when it comes to programming and changing things dynamically, then this one shines. You have the class selector. And the class selector is a dot. So if you write a dot and then a value, in this case avatar, then the browser will look for all elements that have the class avatar. So this p tag and the next p tag, they all have the class avatar, so they will be selected. The div tag in the third row also have avatar in its class list, so that one will be selected. The last one will not be selected. So this is an answer to your question, more or less. So with classes, you can specify which elements of a type that should be selected. If we, however, combine the tag selector, type selector, with the class selector, like this, you have the p dot avatar, then it says take only p elements with the class avatar. So it will discard or not select the div in this case because it's not of type p. However, and this is a tricky part, if you make a space between the P and the avatar, what will happen? You think. You have the clues to know what will happen. So instead of writing the dot exactly after the P, we make a white space. Suggestions. that will be more or less, whoa, like this example with the descendants. So if you add a white space, you will say that select all elements of the class avatar that are inside of a p tag, that has a p tag as a parent. So that's the difference. So class selectors, this is the one you will use the most. Yep.
If you want to style any p or whatever tag, so you have to give them the attributes if you want to style them differently.
Yeah. Yeah, if you so the question is, if you want to style the p tags differently, I'm repeating for the audience because the mic won't catch your question, and to know that I understood you right. So, so if you want to style the p tags differently, should you add different classes to them? Yeah, that's how you do it. Because if you think of a page, it's very seldom that you have blue text and red text and green text, and you have like, this is some quotation, or that's a bad example because you have the quote tag actually for that. Say that you have an, what should we have? A link that you have a list of links, and some of them are more important than others, but they are mixed up in a list. Then you can mark the important one with a class important. And then you can add a bang or something in front of it with a picture or whatever to emphasize that that one is important, for instance. So yeah, you add different class. And look at this example with a div class that have two classes. So you are able to make a list of classes. That's okay. You can have 10 different classes on one element. That's okay. So this one div class will also listen for changes on the class active in that case. Okay, the ID selector is one that is quite commonly used, but you should not use that so much. You can on an element in HTML, you can use the ID attribute. They all have it, as they all have the class attribute. The ID, however, must be unique on the page. So you can't have two elements that has the same value on their ID. You can't have two content on the page. You can have multiple classes, but you can only have one content. However, HTML is forgiving, so you can add many IDs, but the results might be unexpected. Especially when it comes to programming against this. It might work actually in CSS. So if you add three IDs with content and then you select them, all three will probably be changed. But when it comes to JavaScript, the API call requires one element, not an array of elements. So we will only get one element, and I think you will get the last one in that case. Okay, so the ID selector uses this hashtag. So you write hash or and then content in this case, because the ID is content. So we will select one and only one element. This one will should never give you multiple elements on a page. This was used quite frequently before we had the new HTML tags. The header, the footer, the navigation, because then you have a div with ID menu or a div with ID header, and then you wanted to pinpoint the header. Today we have tags instead, so we target the header tag. But yeah, it could be actually that you have multiple head tags as well. Then you can target the head in the body, or you can give that head ID of main header or something like that, if you really want to target it, or give it a class main. There are many ways of doing it.
A question. When you have many classes, in which order are they read?
like avatar and activity.
Yeah. I mean, I guess you need to go down to the rendering engine in the browser to answer that question, because no, the thing is that the styles are computed and then added to the page. So it, yeah, okay, I understand your question. The active says it's red and the avatar says it's blue. Will the text be blue or red?
Yeah.
The answer is that you can change them in the HTML, doesn't matter. It matters in which order they are applied in the CSS. So if you have a dot active before the dot avatar in the CSS, the last one will be the one rendered. So in that case, avatar. But if you make it the other way around, the result is the opposite. So you need to look at the CSS to answer that question. You can't look at the HTML. And we will get to that as well. Okay. There are attribute selectors. I'm just mentioning this so you know that they are there. Those were not heavily used some years ago because of browser incompatibilities, but today with CSS3 and HTML5, you are free to use them. For instance, you can use the square parenthesis like that, saying, okay, select all elements that has the element disabled. So if someone has, if an element has an attribute disabled, that one will be targeted. In this case, we are looking for all elements that has the type equals button. And in this case, this one, the button up here, will be targeted. Have you read regular expressions? Have you learned regular expressions? Okay, some of you. Then you recognize the next one, I guess. It says, take all A elements that has an attribute href that in the beginning has https://, and then something. This rooftop is the same as in regular expressions where it says the beginning of. And the opposite is on the next line, the end of, from the end. Then you have the dollar sign. So take all images that has a source attribute ending with a .png. So if you want to do something with all the PNG images but not the JPEG images, for instance, you can use the later one. And there are a lot more stuff you can do with attribute selectors, but there is no need for me to just try to go through them all right here. The main thing is that you know that, okay, I can target stuff depending on its attributes, more or less. Then you can go into the documentation. So, I mean, you should know this by heart. If I ask you how to select something based upon ID, you should know that it is the hashtag and how to do it, because this is so commonly used. You should know the class selectors. You should know a tag selector. You should know that you can do stuff with attributes. I don't demand that you know them, okay? Class and attributes the same. Yeah, you could actually use, I mean, you could write like this bracket, class equals and something, yeah. But this is a newer edition. This wasn't in the first editions when class were there. Classes, I think, has been there since really early in the CSS specification. This is newer. But you can actually just learn this if you like. It's like regular expressions. You can do stuff in many different ways. Okay, you have relationship expressions, selectors. Well, let's see, we have a question maybe. Does that also apply for the order you include multiple style sheets? I think it's a follow-up to your question here on campus. Yeah, the order of style sheets when you have multiple style sheets are also important, but I'll get to that. The slides are already on the web page. And they are on GitHub, so if you find errors, please change and do a pull request. Okay, relationship selectors. We have already looked at the first one. If E is, select all E's that are the descendants of A with a white space. If we add a greater than sign between those, then it must be a direct child of A. So instead of a descendant, it must be a child of. We have this pseudo, no, it's not a pseudo element actually, but we have this E colon first child that says that, okay, the element must be first child of something. So it must be the first child in a chain. If you have a UL tag with three list elements, this one will only target the first list element because only the first list element is a first child. And E plus, E that is next sibling of B. So if P is a sibling, syskon, to A, then B will be selected. But A won't be selected because it has no sibling before that. So, I mean, you will use the first one a lot, probably the second one sometimes, and occasionally the two at the bottom, but you should know the first one at least by heart. Sometimes you need to, I mean, you don't want to repeat yourself. If you have headings, like heading 1, 2, and 3 on a web page, they probably have something in common, right? Like the font or probably not the size, but maybe the color or margins or something. Then you don't need to repeat that a lot of times, like saying, okay, the H1 should be the font face Times New Roman. H2 should be the font face Times New Roman. H3 should be the Times New Roman, because that's a repeating yourself. Then you can group properties together like this, group selectors with a comma. So this one says, take all H1 elements, all H2, all H3, and apply a rule. And you can, of course, combine it all together with more complex selectors combined with commas. This is the hard part, selecting stuff. Knowing, I mean, okay, we're going to change that, but not that. How to do that? Well, adding properties and values and getting that right could be tedious work as well, but the selectors are really important. We have something called pseudo-class selectors. That's because some elements in HTML have different states. They are not always what they look to be, so they have hidden states. A tags, for instance, or most of elements actually have hidden states, but the A tag is the most common in this regard. And that's because if you think about it, if you look at the web page, it's quite often that you see that if you have visited the page, the link is in another color than it was when it was unvisited. And this stems back to the blue and purple color that we saw in the last lecture. So a link can be in different states. It can be visited, unvisited, or yeah, can be visited anyways. It can have focus. If the user uses the keyboard and tabs, all links on the page will get focus. And some controllers like buttons and form controllers and stuff, but the links will get focus. And then you can change the style depending on the focus. And that's a quite important thing when it comes to accessibility. Because people who are not able to use a mouse, they navigate with a keyboard or a keyboard-like navigation system. Then they need to be able to focus on the links and then press enter to enter the link. And then they need to see which links are selected. Back in the days, it was quite common. I made that mistakes many times that you like added JavaScript to remove this dotted line that came when you tabbed, you tabbed to navigate because it looked ugly, you thought. But that made a huge problem for disabled people because as soon as the link got focus, it lost focus. So you couldn't actually, if you weren't really, really quick, you couldn't navigate those links. You should never ever do stuff like that. Instead, you should try to make it so that it stands out when it has focus. Gets another color, or the shadowing is different, or it moves, something like that. And you have a lot of some other pseudo classes as well. If you are, I mean, do we have an example? That's an easy example, for instance. I mean, this presentation is a web page. And this is a link to go up one slide and go down one slide. And when I hover that link, that A element, the color of the arrow changes. And that is the hover. So when the pointer hovers that element, something changes. Look at the order, and now order is important. Hover is declared below visited. And that's important. If we had put them the other way around, then if I once had visited a link, that will always be under. The visited will always be below hover, which means that the visited will have the most important rule right now. And so if a link is visited, the hover won't work anymore. So in this case, it's important that you specify them in this order for them to work properly altogether. There are a lot of examples of H hovering links with CSS, so you can find a lot, and we have links to the documentation as well. Okay. Oh, I have an example. Okay, that's an example of the first child. I'm not sure why I took that example. Forget it. I should have done something with links instead. Oh, the hard word, specificity. Oh, got it right the first time. Specificity. Yeah. Specificity. That's different rules or selectors has different specificity. So some are more important than others. And this is important to know when writing your CSS. So we will have conflicts, right? One CSS rule is telling all p tags to be green, and another rule are telling the same p tags to be yellow. So which one is it going to be? Is it going to be yellow or green? Because those rules say p tags that are the p tag that has the ID, first p tag, and the class content, that one will be selected by both rules, the same p tag. And on the first glance, you could say that, oh, it will probably be green because that's below. So first the link will be yellow, and then the next rule, because it's red from the top to the bottom, will change it to green. But that's not true. And that is because of specificity. And different selectors have different specificity. And you could symbolize this with values. So ID selector is the most important selector. So we give that a value of 100. A class selector, a value of 10. And tag selectors, the value of 1. So in this case, the first one is a p tag, so it gets a 1 and 100. So 101, the value 101. The next one is a p tag and a class, so that gets 11. 101 is more than 11, so that rule is the one that will be the one changing the color. So in this example, the p tag with the ID first p tag, first p tag will be yellow, and not blue, even if this one says it should be blue. So always, if an ID selector is present, that rule will be more important than other rules. But if you have multiple IDs, then you need to see if someone also added a class selector, because then that will have higher specificity. Have you had Tobias Gidlund in some courses? Yeah. He's a big Star Wars fan, right? Yeah. Damn it, I should have linked. There is a great article where instead of using numbers, they're using like, that's the Empire. Emperor. And that's Darth Vader, and the P tags are stormtroopers. So the Emperor will always beat Darth Vader and the stormtroopers. If I remember, I could link to it. Maybe Jan can send the link in the chat. So don't be fooled. I mean, it's often the last rule that applies, but not certain, because it depends on the specificity. I will show you in the browser how you can like see this in a better way, because it could be hard by just looking at the code and like see what is what. Yeah, property inheritance. That is what we will discuss after the break, 10 minutes. Okay? Before the break, I said that we should talk about property inheritance. It's a good thing that some properties are inherited in CSS. By this I mean, if this is an example. So we have a paragraph of text, and we are telling the text to be of the color red. And then we have an EM emphasizing something in the text. EM will make it italic looking, but most of all it will make it emphasized. That's the semantic meaning. Italic is the graphical representation of the semantics. But it would be a hazard if the red color wasn't inherited down to the child EM, because then that text would be black. And like, if we change the font color of the body element, that is the element surrounding everything, if we change the font color, font face, the font family, to say San Francisco or something, then we would like all the texts on the page to have the San Francisco typeface, and not just stuff lying directly on the body. So some properties are inherited down the chain. Font family is one of those. Colors. Borders are not. So if we tell this p tag to have a border, black border, the EM element will not have a black border. And that's also probably a good thing, right? So often the inheritance is done in such a way that we don't have to think about it, but it's good to know that it's there. If you want to see if a property is inherited, you need to consult the documentation, because it has some information field that says if it's inherited or not. So often you don't need to think about it, but it's good to know that it's there. They are discussing this lecture in on the course webpage. I linked that the wrong way, so you will probably just get the code for the presentation. Jan can probably send the right link in the Slack and live coding channel. It's good I make you work as well, Jan, right? So where to find help? Oh, MDN again. We have looked at it before, but the Mozilla Developer Networks have really good resources for HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So this is a good source of information, a good starting point. Then you might find other references for CSS that you like better. Fine, I don't care. You can use whichever reference you like, but you have good references for CSS here. So you see that it says CSS and CSS 3. So CSS has also version numbers. I think if you watched the last lecture, I had some timeline and you saw CSS 1, CSS 2, and CSS 3 probably on the slides. So CSS 3 is, you often say HTML 5 and CSS 3 because they are kind of in the same era. There is a big difference between CSS 3 and CSS 2 in how they are constructed and how they look upon the specification. However, they are backward compatible, so CSS 2 rules still apply in CSS 3, so you can always look at the CSS 3 reference. But in CSS 2, they had a big reference with everything in one document. In CSS 3, they have divided everything down to modules. So if you look at the CSS 3 specification, it's a long way from finished because there are a lot of modules that are only drafts or even IDs on a paper, more or less. And there are some modules that are completely finished. So modules that were present in the older versions, they are finished, and newer proposals are not even implemented in any browser. So you can always go to canius.com that I showed before the break to find if something is implemented in a good way. And if you go into the guides, you will find guides about the selectors. You will find all the properties and how to use them. You will probably, for the exam assignment, need some kind of guide how to make columns and stuff. So that's up to you and find something like that. The meaning of those lectures are more to get you started, get you into the field. And you are, of course, it's okay to ask questions as well in the Slack channel. So we talked about indenting code, and what about readable CSS? Well, in CSS there are a lot of different styles of writing CSS codes. Some of you are probably familiar with the upper one, with having a lot of rules on one line. Others like to divide it into separate lines. And maybe use indention to show that, okay, those two rules down here are in some way related to the one above. Or you just write them neat like this when tabbing. They are a hazard to sustain and have all the colons in the same aligned way. But some like those as well. So you can do whatever you like. We don't have any style rules for CSS in the course, so you can do it like whatever however you like. But I would recommend being consequent, doing it the same way over and over again. I will show you how to do comments. I would recommend using comments to divide, so you have easier to find in your code, because CSS will be a lot of code really quick. And this takes us back to the question before about dividing this into different files. And we can. I mean, we can have one file for specifying colors, one file for specifying typefaces, one file for specifying the layout, one file for printable versions, if we like, one file for different kind of mobile environments and stuff. We could have 20 files. The problem with HTTP 1.1 is that reading a lot of files cost. I mean, it's a request and a response that will take time for the user. And if you have 20 style sheets, the initial page load will be probably quite slow. And that's why it's a good thing to stuff them all together into one file and deliver that file to the user instead. Of course, there are tools that could help us with this, and I will get into that soon. Comments. You are familiar with the multi-line comments. It's the same as in Java or many different programming languages. I have done this a lot of times using the single line comment. They are not working in CSS, so don't try. Just use the multi-line comments. Order matters. So as I said, the rules are interpreted from the top to the bottom. So the web browser will start adding them from the first rule down to the last. So on the way, a text could be both red, blue, and then at the end green, depending on specificity and where in the document it is located. And the same thing applies to the order in files. So in this case, we have two style sheets. We have one called reset.css and one main.css. So the reset.css rules will be applied first, and then anything in the main.css will overwrite settings in the reset.css. So yes, the order matters, but I mean, you can see it as a big file. First you have the reset.css, and then you copy in the main.css in the bottom. So, the properties. We haven't touched upon the properties. We have looked at like color, maybe. And there are a lot of properties. I won't go through them here, but you can, of course, as I said, change the fonts, the typefaces. You can change the text in adding margins and the text height, line height, separation between letters, stuff like that. You can work with the graphic of the page with colors, borders, shadows, different kind of effects. In CSS3, you have modules that helps you do different kind of transformations. You can transform objects, skew them and rotate them and flip them, and you can do a lot of stuff with CSS. You can add rounded borders and shadow effects, and you can do transitions even. You can make it so that you have one CSS effect and then you have a timing to go to another effect, so you can have like stuff almost animating on the page only using CSS. You can do a lot of stuff with CSS. And somewhere you need to take a decision, okay, should I do this with CSS or should I actually do it with JavaScript? I would argue that if it's a visual effect, you should use CSS. And if it's a more, I mean, you have a, if you have an intention of doing something in the application, then you may add it with JavaScript and maybe add some of the transition magic and the graphics using CSS. So it's a mix between the both of them.
A question?
Yep.
It's different on performance, right?
Is it different of performance? Oh, that's a good question. I can't answer that one. You mean like say we want to flip an image upside down?
Yeah.
Yeah, you can do it with CSS or you can do it with JavaScript.
Yeah.
If you do it with CSS, is it pushed to the graphic card and take help with the hardware? I can't answer that. Sorry, I don't know. In a good browser, it should be. If it benefits from using the graphic card, I would hope that the browser would use the graphic card to do that animation. But if you're doing that kind of stuff, then, and it's important to get performance, then you really need to go deep and find out how to get the benefits. And it could be, as you said, maybe in some cases it's better to use JavaScript APIs or JavaScript frameworks to do that kind of stuff. And in some cases it's better to do it in CSS. Often, the more you leave to the browser, the better. So if the browser in some way have an API that makes you do something, that's probably faster than trying to do it in some other way. But I mean, in this case, it could be that the browser exposes both options. And yeah. But anyway, I would try to separate it so that visual effects is done by CSS and non-visual effects done in JavaScript, just to separate it and to make the designers go nuts with the CSS and developers can concentrate on the behavior. If you are working in teams. Layout. This is one important one. This is among the first things you do when you build a new page. You have some basic layout. We saw the example I had with the navigation, a side, the middle content, and the header. You need to set that up. You need to move the boxes so they get into that order. And that's what you do with layout. There are a lot of, in CSS3, a lot of different ways you can do layout. So try to read up on that topic and find something that fits or suits you. And then, as I said, you can add animations, transformations, and transitions to stuff. We won't get into you will probably only need to use the free upper ones in this course, but you are allowed to do. I mean, we had someone doing some kind of card game in the last assignment last year. Then they added transformations using CSS to flip the cards. So you can do stuff like that. Okay, I haven't touched upon responsive web pages yet. I will. Couple of minutes anyway. But the concept of responsive web pages came up like 2012, 13, something like that, when we saw the market for smartphones growing and saw that users are using the smartphones to browse the web. When I had a smartphone or feature phone back in 2004, 2005, I tried to browse the web, and we had something called the mobile web, and we had mobile standards in the XHTML family that were used to solve those problems. But as I said before, XHTML went down the drain, and now it's HTML5 for all the way. So now we are instead constructing pages using CSS to handle those different environments. So your web page can run in a browser, it can run on a big screen, it can run in a smartphone, on a tablet, it can run in portrait or landscape mode. So you have a lot of different setups where your web page or application can be shown. So then we need those responsive pages. And just to show an example, we can use the LNU page. So if we visit lnu.se, we will get the full big picture. We will get the desktop version. And it's so slow. That's probably the browser here. Okay. Yeah, so we have a layout like this. If we scroll down, we have multiple columns, even three columns down below. Here are four columns. Because we're on the desktop, we have the room to fit everything in. So if I start to manipulate the window, you will see that somewhere here we have a breaking point. So what the developers has done is said that, okay, below a certain width of the browser window, we will change the layout. So instead of four columns here, we will probably have three columns. The one in the middle is a little bit more narrow, and we only have three columns down below. up on the top, it's more or less the same, but the menu disappeared and it's now some kind of mobile menu. Okay, so this I would say is like the iPad version or the landscape version of a phone maybe. And then you can shrink it, and we will see soon that we have, okay, I missed it. There, I think it is. Click. There we go over to the mobile version. So this is just versions of the mobile version here. So this one is optimized for scrolling up and down. And if you look at users on phones, they are really used to swiping up and down. So it's you always want a page that are long, not wide, because users are not that used to swipe left and right on smartphones. They want to scroll up and down. So how is it done? Oh, well, they use something called media queries to find out the different widths of the windows. And it's not that tricky, actually. If we look at this example, we have a link linking in the style sheet called example.css. And we have used the media attribute and specified that this example.css will only be used to a max width of 800 pixels. So when the page or window is 800 pixels, this one will be used, and it will also be used at 100 pixels. But if we go above 800 pixels, this style sheet will not be in effect anymore. So by using those media queries, we can set up different widths, that key widths that will trigger the layout to change. And I would recommend to have like one CSS file with everything that is common on all layouts, like colors and fonts and stuff. And then you will separate the layouts in different files. Or you can use the media directive in the CSS file. You use the @media and then curly braces like this. And everything you write inside of that media query will be, in this case, applied for everything with a max width of 600 pixels. So you don't need separate CSS files. You can add everything in one file if you like. And there are a lot of things you can do with media. You can actually prompt it to say that, okay, when this is shown on a TV or a device that identifies itself as a TV, you can add a style sheet for that. The most common use is print. So you can add a style sheet that will be applied when printing the web page. So if you have like a booking site or something like that, and you want the users will probably want to print tickets or receipts or something like that, then you can have a CSS file for made just for that that thing. So the user will see the page as usual with the browser style sheet, add print or print the page, and when the printer requests the page, it will identify itself as a printer, and the printer style sheet will be added instead. Yep.
So one page is designed in like several times and then applied for, if it's a different width, then we can apply a user.
Yeah, so the question is the web page designed several times and served differently? I would say that the HTML code is always the same. Mm-hmm. So you have one HTML code and you have all common CSS code in one file, but then you identify the differences. Okay, two columns, three columns, and then in one file or in one media directive like this, you have two column layouts, and in another one you have three. So when the browser detects that you passes those spots like 600 and 800, then the browser will automatically just change to whatever layout you like. You can even specify landscape and portrait if you want to know if the user is holding the phone like this or like this. Probably you don't have use for that if you're not making games or something like that, then it could be good to know. You have JavaScript APIs that could use the gyroscope in the phone, but most often you will just focus on the width because it's, I mean, you don't care if it's an iPad or an Android phone in landscape. You just care about how much width is available. But you can query stuff like landscape. You can query if it's a black and white screen of some reason. You can query if it's a projector projecting the web page. So there are a lot of stuff going on. Yeah. Yeah, some questions about the web page, but the course page, but Jan is taking care of that. You don't need to implement media queries in the course. We don't have time to add too much on you for the first assignment. You're allowed to, of course. We have a grade in this course, and the grade is it's A2E, right? You have the international scale. So those are stuff that during the exam oral hearing will, I mean, if you have done a lot of work with media queries, you could have that as a bonus, for instance. So.
But that was the requirement, isn't it?
Was it the requirement to
resize?
Yeah, it should resize, but we don't have a requirement that you need to trigger something, some different layouts, but it should be able to handle resizes, yeah. So yeah, you could interpret it as you need this. Okay, yeah, okay, yeah. Jan wrote the one, I read it, so I should know. Okay, just a quick talk about CSS frameworks and preprocessors. So I'm lousy at design. I mean, if I were trying to draw something on the board, you wouldn't see if it's a cow or a dog or even a car, I guess. So my design skills are bad, but I like to code. I like to create stuff. So how do we do it when we are bad designers, but some of you are probably really good designers, but I'm not, and I know that some of you aren't. So how do we fool everybody? Yeah, we use frameworks. We use something that someone has told us how to do stuff to make them look good. I mean, what spacing should we have between letters and stuff like that? If you're writing Android applications, you are probably using Materialize, it's called, right? Materialize UI or something. Hasn't Google some design rules telling you how to do stuff so it doesn't look terrible? Isn't it called Materialize? Yeah, it is. Okay, good. And in iOS, I guess Apple has told the developers quite hold them strict so they can't do anything. In CSS, we can do anything. We have a blank page to start with, and some of us don't like that, me included. So I prefer to have something to start off with. And there are a lot of frameworks that help us do columns, to help us make beautiful forms and have the right text indention and stuff like that. Here are some examples. Bootstrap is probably the most known one, together with Foundation and maybe Semantic UI. I found some other ones that I haven't tried out, like Material Framework and Materialize, and those are like answers to the Google Materialize environment. So if you like that one, you would probably like to use those for web pages. I will have a look at that code in a moment. I would argue that you are not here because you want to be web designers. You are here because you want to be web developers or use your development skills to write applications on the web or connect stuff with the web. And if you are not designers, I would recommend you to to try to use frameworks because they will ease stuff, make stuff easier for you. But as with all frameworks, this will add cost. They will add rendering time. There will be a lot of stuff in Bootstrap that you never use but still load to the page if you're not careful. On the other hand, those are often distributed on CDN networks, so that if the user has visited another site using Bootstrap, much stuff could already be cached in the browser. Jan, we need to make a decision. Is it okay to use frameworks on the first assignment? This is well planned. For me it is. Okay, yeah, for me as well. So if you like, you're free to use frameworks at the first assignment. Yeah, why not? I mean, the most important stuff is that you learn stuff that you actually can use later on, and you will use frameworks. So please go ahead, use frameworks at the first assignment. That's okay. CSS processors. Anyone worked with CSS processors before? Pre-processors? Okay, so this is the thing. When you start to write CSS, as developers, you will miss a lot of stuff. You will immediately find that, oh shit, I cannot make inheritance. I need to inherit those rules into this one. I need to copy them. What the heck? And then you need to copy. And then if you want to change that, you need to change it on another place. Can't use variables. I need to add this exact color 15 times. I can't even store it in a variable and reuse it. You will go nuts, basically, because you know better than CSS. So we have a tool to help us. We have CSS preprocessors. So this is adding kind of a programming language upon CSS. So you can use variables, you can use like functions, you can inherit stuff. It's an extension of the CSS language. The CSS language is not a language, it's just stuff. But CSS preprocessors added language to CSS, and it's really neat. Like, damn it, next slide. Yeah. Well, why should we? Yeah, as I said, you are developers. You want less CSS to you will see that the CSS files will be huge, and you will have like duplicated code everywhere. But using preprocessors, you can reduce that. You get a better organization. You can separate into many files. And during the building process, everything is put together in a minified file that you can distribute to your users. You can use variables. You can make calculations. You can use arithmetics inside of CSS. So you can calculate the width of stuff, if you like. Can't do that in CSS. Ah, well, I think in all of those modules coming to CSS, there are proposals and some more or less ready to do stuff like this. So I guess somewhere in the future, those things will be in the CSS standard, but they aren't today. So how does a CSS processor work? Well, this is something you need to install locally or in your Vagrant machine, for instance. So what you do is you write CSS in another language called, for example, Sass or Less or whatever, Stylus. So you write in another language with another syntax. And then you compile or pre-process that language, and it will be pre-processed into CSS code for you. And that CSS code is interpreted by the browser, because the browser won't accept Sass or Less code. It will only accept CSS code. So this is done on your local machine or your development environment. That's another tool. That's something you need to set up. That's something you need to have in your build chain when you develop. You will get in trouble immediately, because when you try to look at the CSS in the browser, it's not the same code as you have on your local machine. So if you have an error in the browser on row 3, it could correspond to something on row 69 in one of your files on your local system. So you get a messy system that way. There are help, however. You can use connections between the browser. You can add certain files, meta files, to your build project that will make the browser connect your files and show them in the browser, so you can actually see where stuff got wrong. So there are help for that as well. But it's a, I mean, using CSS frameworks, it's really easy to get started with and use them. Using preprocessors, that's a little bit the next level. Yeah.
But if you're using a CSS framework and you want to write SASL, how do you?
That's shouldn't be any problem. I guess there are a lot of projects handling that because that's probably what modern web developers want to do. They want to write Bootstrap code using SAS, for instance. So yeah, I think you can go to the Bootstrap page and see how to do it, or the SAS page how to do it. Yeah.
Which one is the most popular?
I would argue less or SAS. That's up to taste. We have gone for SAS. So I think it's because it's, we're using in another course, we're using Jekyll, which is a static site generator. I won't go into that, but in Jekyll, it was quite easy to use SAS, so that's why we used it. And I think we met one of the makers on a conference. And that. So I don't have a logical reason for saying SAS, so you can say less. Or you can say stylus, or you can say anything other than that. But if you're new, I would go for less or SAS if you want to try them out. Go to the web pages, just have a look if it's something for you or not. But it's a really great tool to have in the toolbox as a web developer. Okay, I have a couple of minutes. I have questions. Oh, I need to take that question later, because that was a long one with a lot of code as well. Okay, just some words about the developer tools in the browser, because that's good to know, especially when you're getting into this. When I started out, there were terrible tools in the browser. No tools at all. You just had to watch the page, hope for the best. If it didn't work, try to alter something and hope for the best again. When you're writing Java programs, you probably have a debugger, right? So you use the debugger to debug your programs, and that makes it a whole lot easier than just trying to build and not knowing what failed. So in today's browsers, in all of them, from Internet Explorer to Edge to Firefox to Safari to Chrome to Opera, we have modern, and even on the mobile phones, we have modern development tools built in with debuggers and stuff. So you right click and take inspect. So this view has the developer tools. When developing in HTML, we get the HTML code. And this is how the code is interpreted by the browser. So if you have written falsy code, you can see the result here. So this is how the browser interpreted your falsy code. So this is the result. And that's why if you have written everything in one line, it's still a really good view here. You can use the select element to find elements. So this header here, okay, so it's looks like that. We could activate stuff, we can delete it, hide it, but best of all, we can let's see, it's down below. We can look at the CSS code as well. So in this view, we have the styles. And you see there is a lot of strike through going on. And strike through equals override. So somewhere down the chain, it were supposed to be a WebKit transform that translated something with 150%, but it's striked through because higher up the chain or down the files, or depending on specificity, then something changed this rule, so it's not applied anymore. So you can use this view to browse what kind of CSS rules are applied. And you also have this rule here with all the CSS properties and what they are set to. Some of them are default, but some of them are changed as well. In this view, you can even do stuff like adding rules. So we can say body I'm writing at the wrong keyboard again. We can say body and do something with body background padding. Let's say padding. Yeah. Everything, yes, we added padding to the body, so everything changed. We can add background. Not sure this will work, but let's see. Red. Yeah. And we can change the background. So you can actually, inside of the browser, you can code and change stuff on the fly. So if I reload the page, all changes will be lost. But actually, you can hook up the browser to your local file system if you like. And you can actually use the browser as the development tool if you really, really like this view. I don't do that, but some do. So please go ahead. There are great talks on YouTube on the developer tools. I recommend watching one or two. Because if you can work with this tool, there is a lot one. You will, if you master this one, you will find errors more quickly. You can test stuff easier. We have stuff like, let's remove those. You can click the mobile view up here. This is Chrome. They are similar menus in Safari, and Edge have similar stuff as well. And then we can say, okay, I want to watch this page on iPhone 6. It doesn't work at all. It looks like this on an iPhone 6. So you can emulate different phones and how stuff will work on your web page based upon those phones. And you can even rotate. So, okay, what about landscape? Yeah, landscape with the keyboard up. Okay, it will look like this. So this is a really great tool to just test stuff out because it's expensive to have a lot of phones hooked up. Right, that's all the time I've got. It's a lot of stuff compressed together, as I said. Now it's up to you to experiment further, look up the resources on the course webpage. The next week, we will set our teeth into JavaScript, and that will probably be a lot to take in as well. So try to use this week until next Wednesday to read up upon HTML and CSS so you can focus on JavaScript from the next week because there will be a lot of JavaScript, okay?